What was the quote?
I sent it to him. I said, the system that made MJ.
That made MJ.
Yeah. But that'll be talked about with Phil. See, we can't even joke about it, but everyone's shaking their head. Everyone relax. Relax. So, the triangle. Sorry, so we can stay on focused here. The triangle will be talked about when Phil Jackson and Tex Winter come out. That's not going to be like two separate things.
Right. Exactly. That's perfect.
Okay. Processing.
The funny thing is that Zach's supposed to be a moderator who's kind of like running the show to create conversation, and we're all on the defensive right now, ready to pounce.
Yeah. I am gonna ask that question. So the Last Dance episode.
It was the way you said
it. So.
I just had to get into it.
Yeah. 3 and 4.
Stop
waving
your hands again.
Mufasa. So.
As soon as I said it, I heard him breathe like he was laughing.
Trying to hold it in.
Oh.
Alright, here we go.
Last night, episode 3 and 4 of The Last Dance. I would say number 1 and 2 definitely lived up to the billing. But lots went on last night, too. Between the non-handshake, Dennis Rodman's life, Phil Jackson, Jordan, clearly still hitting Detroit, on and on and on. What was your guys' favorite moment from last night, Scott?
I don't know about you guys, but I'm so disappointed when it ends. You know, I'm so disappointed when I know 11 o'clock's rolling around and it's almost over. And I was telling my wife that I almost wish that this was like a current reality TV show. And there's going to be season after season after season as long as the ratings keep up. But I know there's an end, and it sucks because it's so well done. It's so well done. Honestly, my highlight of last night's show was, I think it was part of the first hour. There was like a 20, and I tweeted it. There was like a 20-second Jordan highlight montage that was young, athletic Air Jordan at his best, like 20 seconds long. And I could watch that stuff. I could watch that stuff on loop for hours and hours and hours and hours and hours.
Yep.
So, I mean, that's what got me the most excited. Obviously, I got really, really emotional when, you know, it showed him hugging that first trophy, because I think the show did a really good job of building it up to that point, all the hurdles he had to overcome. I thought it brought you on that ride, you know, and it's a trip down memory lane that literally I got all choked up. I'm not going to say I was close to crying.
Some tears?
But I could have. I mean, if I could cry right now when I saw him hugging that trophy in the locker room after winning that first championship. And then obviously, you know, the Rodman stuff, which we can get into later, was very, very interesting. I think it's safe to say that there's never been a person like him before or since, for sure. Complete one of a kind. Not just his personality, but even from his production standpoint and the way that he made an impact on the game. I don't think there's ever been anyone like him before or since. That was interesting. The Phil Jackson footage from his younger days was interesting. You know, what a weird body. You know what I mean? What a weird body.
Looked weirdly athletic, though.
Yeah,
he shouldn't be athletic.
It looked like
was.
If you touched him, you were going to get hurt because it was just sharp
bones,
sharp points everywhere.
Yeah, he definitely gets some elbows in somewhere.
Yes, intentionally or unintentionally, right. He was moving around. People were getting bruised up. That was cool. So I never knew honestly that he coached for a period of time in Puerto Rico. Some of that footage was pretty fun. It's just so well done. It's just such a well done documentary. There's a reason why it's, you know, the biggest thing, you know, on the planet right now. And I think the filmmaking has a lot to do with it.
Yep.
Because it gets you into it. It engulfs you.
Yep.
For sure.
Yeah, I mean, I liked his comments sitting at home. Obviously, all that stuff that Scott said, but his comments now, you know, when they go back. You know, he's still pissed off at the Pistons. You know, I think they portrayed that perfectly. You know, they made them look like the bad guys, which they were. I think the Scotty Burrell comments on the plane were pretty hilarious. The Carmen Electra story was pretty funny, you know, when they went down and got Dennis to, you know, bring him to practice. It's well done, and I know it's probably the fact that everybody's quarantined is why it's so big, but I think even if it was everything was normal, I still think it would be well attended,
yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
Seth?
Yeah, I second that. I could watch Jordan Loop just on repeat. His highlight film is second to nobody's. But my favorite is the Dennis Rodman saga, so to speak. The guy that won championships in Detroit was on the high life, top of his profession. And then he went to San Antonio, I believe, right?
Yeah.
And kind of the wheels fell off. And his life, both on the court and off the court, he really struggled. And then he gets a second chance for greatness. And we'll probably get into it later, but there's not any other coach in America that could have handled
right.
the Rodman experience as well as Phil Jackson handled it. And as a head coach, you know, it makes me think like how I handle a lot of players exactly the same. And that might be a default on my end, because look what he got out of Dennis Rodman by, you know, making that leash a little bit longer. He knew what that individual player needed at that specific time. And also with Phil Jackson being a little bit off-centered with his Zen stuff and yoga, all that good stuff.
The picture of him in the back of the car after taking acid.
Yeah. Those two fit together like, you know, peanut butter and jelly for some reason.
Yeah. But,
I got to tell you one thing. I'm not doing yoga with my team.
Yeah.
But, I think that was my favorite part, was the trial and tribulations of Dennis Rodman.
Yeah.
Yeah, you guys, well, obviously one of the biggest things which took over TV this morning, took over social media, was the non-handshake. The Bulls finally got over the hump and beat the Pistons, and led by Laimbeer and Isaiah Thomas, they walked out on them. They didn't shake hands. They didn't do anything. You listen to Isaiah Thomas speak, it was overblown. You listen to other people speak, and they're pretty passionate about that it wasn't. So, what are you guys' thoughts on that?
Well, I mean, from a documentary standpoint, the handshake was probably only like a 5-minute part of it. You know what I mean? It wasn't all about the handshake. It was all about the Pistons. You know, not all about the Pistons. Obviously, Dennis Rodman, you know, and Phil Jackson were a majority of last night, you know, and the Pistons and getting over the Pistons and all that stuff. But the handshake, you know, was a big deal for a week. You know, as far as big news. So for it to all be about the handshake, I think was more in the public and social media. I don't think the documentary made it a point to the handshake on its own. The handshake was was part of it. Obviously, to hear Jordan's comments afterwards, you know, and we lived it. We lived it, and it was right during peak hatred of Detroit. And that was a perfect capper in that whole, you know, 4 or 5 year run with the Pistons for them to go out like that. Now, obviously, you got the Isaiah Thomas, and you got his excuses or reasons or regret, and then Jordan's reaction to that is why I love the guy. Is why he's a god. It, you know, to me, he couldn't have reacted to that now 20. Jeez, I'm no Aiden. How many do the math for me? Since that handshake in 32 years.
Wow.
For, you know, for him to react that way.
Does that mean they haven't talked since then?
I mean, you see footage of them shooting the baloney during games, you know, after that stuff. But they're certainly not friends. have they talked since then? You know, probably, but clearly Jordan, you know, is not a fan of his at all still. And I agree with him, because we lived it. You know, we were there. We knew, you know, of all the stuff and the antics that Isaiah Thomas had. You know, and you got, you know, the younger generation who's hearing Isaiah Thomas interviews because he made the circuit, and hearing his excuses and oh, we were just, no. I mean, you created the Bad Boys. You created a style of play that made you guys two-time champions. You know what I mean? You were great at that. You were great at being that, and it was successful for you. But you have to deal with the public consequence of how you were viewed. You got to own it.
Yep.
And for him to all this time later, you know, try to say, oh, you know, we were hated and we didn't, you know, we. No, I mean, you literally played that way. Not just the Bulls. They beat everybody up. There was a montage of them being the Bad Boys, and look at their 30 for 30. They weren't just beating Jordan up in the Bulls. They were playing that way against everybody. That's why everybody hated him. That's why he's in the locker room during the Celtics and making very, very ill-timed comments about Larry Bird and what if he was, you know, if he wasn't a white guy, you know, he would be just an average basketball player. You got to deal with the public fallout from those comments. You know, you got to deal with whatever perception that your comments and your actions, you know, those have consequences, and you can't whine about them afterwards and say, oh, if I knew then. But no, at that time the whole league hated you because of how you behaved, and that didn't change any of my feelings towards him, because I was there during that time, and there was no more hated person for me than Isaiah Thomas and Bill Laimbeer and Rick Mahorn. And
so he's crying wolf to you.
Yeah, I mean, I don't care. I don't care. I mean, come out and say, I regret everything that I did. I regret that you know, we didn't shake their hands. You know, that would go a long way for me. But to make excuses and the whole the Celtics did it to us is baloney. It's just a baloney excuse, and he knows the differences between the two. It's just and this is why I love Jordan's reaction to it, because it doesn't make any sense. To anyone that knows the situation on why the Celtics walked off against them. You know, go look at the footage. Go look at the footage of how that game was starting to end. People were already storming the court. There was a security concern. And any of us old-timers remember that when the Celtics beat the Lakers, the whole Boston Gardens floor got mobbed. And even Larry Bird, the winner and the home team, was fearful of his safety and had to sprint off his own home court. And that was going to be the same way with the Pistons finally overcoming the Celtics, you know, at the Superdome or the Palace. You know, and Larry Bird was hated by the Detroit fans, and because they beat the Pistons up for so long. So as that series is coming to an end and they're about ready to go on to the finals, they had to get out of there. And that was a 100% complete safety concern related. When the Pistons did it to the Bulls, it was in Detroit. There was no safety concern. So to say that it's apples for apples, we did it because the Celtics did it for us, it was a completely different situation. And for him, and he knows that. And for him to say that that was the reason why they did it, it was because the Celtics did it to them, is complete horse crap, in my opinion.
Go ahead, Seth.
No, I totally agree. But I guess go back to the handshake is that, to me, it makes me seem like the Pistons are the ultimate front runners. You saw a film of Jordan. You think, as competitive as Michael Jordan is, you think he wanted to shake everybody's hand to the team they hated more than anybody? But I think they're ultimate frontrunners. When the going is good, they look like they're kind of great sports, and then they're shaking Jordan's hand and laughing. And then the one time Jordan finally got him back after 3 years of just, you know, hell for him, they show zero class. And walking off the court with nobody rushing the floor, with, I don't know, 7 seconds to go, and you're going to walk by the Chicago Bulls bench, that shows you how mentally tough the Bulls got that year, because if I'm in their shoes, I don't know how they can just stand up and just watch them walk by you. You know what I mean? I was dumbfounded that nothing happened right there. But again, they put him in the rear view after that. But, you know, this idea, like, I hate Bill Laimbeer, but one thing I love about Bill Laimbeer is he owns it. You know, he owned it today on the media circuit. He went out and said, yeah, the Bulls are whiners about it. He called them out about it. Bill Laimbeer never ran away from it. It's like Isaiah Thomas trying to rewrite history, in my opinion. You play basketball in a disgusting, embarrassing way. You won championships because of it. And I'm glad that era's that style is gone.
So you think he's crying wolf too? You think it's a load of garbage?
Yeah, he's yeah. complete. You know, he's rewriting history.
Yeah.
You know, he goes on there. He's like, I've suffered more than any. He, like today, he said on the media circuit, he's suffered more than anybody. Okay, he was beat up just as he was beat up more than Michael Jordan, which is a complete lie.
Yeah.
Okay, and it's just him trying to rewrite history and control the narrative of how his team played. I'd respect him more if he came out and said, yeah, this is the way we played. We'll put you on your we'll play dirty, but we won two championships. It is what it is.
Yeah.
You know, and then trying to run away from who you were.
Yeah.
And if he got beat up, it was 100% in retaliation for the way that they were playing, and I think more teams should have done it. No, other teams didn't want to play that way. There was. I mean, Jordan went public with how they're hurting the league with their style. You know what I mean? But at some point, teams are going to fight back. At some point, teams are going to hit you back. You know, and so I mean, for him to be whining about how he got beat up more than anybody else, you know, it's like good. You know, you deserved it. You guys created that image and that style. And for other teams to say, you hit us, we're going to hit you. You come down the lane and you go vertical, I'm going to elbow you just like you do to us every single time.
Yep.
Straight up bitches.
Oh, my God.
So if they would have not, like, had a name under Horace Grant, would you have recognized that was Horace Grant?
No. I would.
Holy cow! I mean, I was like, wow.
Blew up a little bit.
He looks better now.
He was like a specimen, wasn't he? Or was he?
No, I don't think he's... I think he's bulked up. Like, oh, muscular, time. Right? Yeah. I didn't think he was, like, overweight. I thought he was, like...
Jacked.
Yeah.
Jacked.
It's like, holy cow!
Yeah.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Isn't the best with Horace Grant was... After he said that famous quote, he's wearing NBA cares.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't even notice that until someone pointed it out on Twitter. I didn't notice what shirt he had on.
So zero validity from any of you, even in the slightest bit. Right?
No, okay. Zero. Zero, because, I mean, his main reasons of why doing it are completely, like he said, he's trying to rewrite history, you know, to he knows the reason why the Celtics did it. And right. For him to say, we did it because the Celtics did it to us.
You said it was a passage, right? Right.
Yeah, it was a rite of passage. Right. So does...
Completely wrong.
So obviously they beat the hell out of Jordan and everyone that came in their path. On the flip side of hating them, and this came up today too, is does Jordan have a little bit of thanks to give to the Pistons in the sense that... And again, it was Thomas speaking, so I don't know if this is a more known thing or thought thing, where he said the Bulls became mentally tough because of us, that they had to, and they kind of got that chip on their shoulder because they had to go through us, and once they got through us, they became the team that they were. So do they owe a little bit of thanks to the Pistons, you think, at all? Or
so what
that, I mean, so is there thing to that?
That's the truth.
But I think they would.
I don't mean like an actual outset of thanks, but like, there's something to that.
No, because I think the way Michael Jordan is, why he's the greatest ever, is because he was going to become that competitive anyway, no matter if it was the Pistons were there or not.
It was Pippen and Grant getting to a point where
they were going to be that way no matter what, whether it was the Pistons or not. I mean, there's always going to be another team that stands in the other team's way. That's why it's sports. But
right,
I don't think it. I mean, his competitiveness. I think all pro athletes are competitive. I mean, that's why they're professionals. To say that one is more competitive than the other is kind of crazy, but I think his desire to win, they would have won, you know, the same amount, even if the Pistons didn't exist.
Right. Didn't matter who was there. They were going to keep going until they beat him.
I think the only thing it does is, the only thing I'll give the Pistons credit, it kind of adds to Jordan's aura a little bit, so to speak. But again, first year Jordan played with an all-star, went to the Eastern Conference Finals, Game 7. Next year, he went on that championship.
And he didn't really have that all-star in that game.
Other players maturing and developing as, you know, basketball players and the Pistons, you know.
What, I mean, I don't even understand why Isaiah Thomas would go on national television and embarrass himself that way. He owes us thanks. I don't think there's any validity to it at all. I don't know what he's looking for by even stating that, to be honest with you. It's annoying. It's just it's what adds to the hatred of any Jordan fan and Bulls fan during that time. That isn't.
And the whole thing is too bad. Like Seth said, if they'd come out and just embrace who they were, I think they would probably be looked at as one of the best 3 or 4, 5 year stretches for a team. Because of how they're trying to play it off.
Sure.
No one views the Pistons as this likable all-time great team that they could have been viewed as.
It would still not change my hatred of them, and I don't think it would change Jordan's hatred. It would be better for them to say, yeah, you know, F you, that's who we were.
Right, that's what I'm
saying. I mean, I would have a little bit more respect for them, but the hatred would still be there. It wouldn't change my feelings towards them other than, you know, Laimbeer owning it and being that guy doesn't make me all of a sudden like him. It doesn't make me all of a sudden, it just makes him him. You know, it makes him him and not, you know, a phony. That's all
I think it's such a misconception, and we're all head coaches here. I think it's such a misconception that, you know, that they're a great defense team because they clothesline people. That's it's argument, in my opinion. They're a great defense team. They could play a different style and still won 2 championships. They had Joe Dumas, they had Thomas. They had great post players. You know, they got Dennis Rodman that, you know, got Michael Jordan on the perimeter. You know, like they can guard all 5.
Yeah.
Can guard all 5 positions. Like, it's just that. You know, I think they win either way, but they went down a road that nobody in the NBA, you know, respected.
Well, before they started demolishing Jordan, Jordan demolished them. I mean, Jordan embarrassed them multiple times. He had 60-some-odd points and beat them. I mean, he was beating them. You know, maybe not a 7-game series, but times during the regular season, he would absolutely embarrass them. Before the Jordan rules and before the, when you come in the lane, we're gonna knock you out. You know, he was torching them at their place. You know, I mean, he was making, I mean, there was Easter games where he's dropping 50 and hitting, you know, with by himself before Pippen was even there. When a one-man, you know, team, essentially, you know, was embarrassing them during certain games. They talked about it in the documentary, you know, he would literally, you know, embarrassing them. And that's when the whole Jordan rules, and I just don't buy the intricate facts of the Jordan rules. If he goes left, there's going to be someone there. We want to do this. We want to do that. If you watch it, he got wherever he wanted to. When he got in the lane, he got crushed. There was 3 or 4 guys on him, and they would the specifics. When they get into the specifics of if he catches it on the right wing, we're going to do this. We're going to do that. I just don't buy any of that, because when you watch the footage, you know he's doing whatever he wants. You know, until he, you know, comes into the lane, he's getting taken to the floor.
I'm sure they. I mean, you can still have those rules, though, right?
Yeah.
I mean, he's Michael Jordan, so he's going to go where he wants anyway. But I'm sure all those rules
why
existed.
Wouldn't those basketball-specific rules be in place before that?
I don't know.
You know, I mean, was the scouting not done prior when he was dropping 60, you know, 60 on him?
Well, maybe that's why they did that, because he was dropping 60 on him.
No, the only thing that changed, the fact, is that every time he comes in the lane, we're going to put him on the floor. That was the big difference between before and after. It wasn't everything else, because the same coaching staff's there, the same personnel's there. You tell me all of a sudden now we're gonna have all of these fine little points. No, the difference is that we're gonna start dropping it.
That was what he said. If they left the floor,
yeah,
he was gonna be on the floor.
Right,
that was the rule.
Right, I'm just saying he's good enough to get where he wants to regardless. So maybe they went over those rules with the team. Like, when he goes left, we're doing this, but you just can't do it because it's Jordan. That's what I'm saying.
No, I think they try to make it out to be technical basketball rules, which they didn't. The only rule was if he leaves the ground in the paint, he ends up on the ground.
Right.
That was their rule.
Right.
Okay. So,
because they could never own
So Dennis Rodman.
Right.
Dennis,
just saying that.
So Dennis Rodman, okay, another big part of the stuff, the shows last night. He's such an interesting guy. Whether it's his basketball or his personality, you know, I could go on and on about it, but I'm going to let you guys do it. Just talk about him. Talk about him with the Pistons, with the Bulls, his personality. I don't even know where to go with him. He's such a different
human being.
Holy
cow. Seth, you want to go?
I'll start with... no one in NBA history filled a role who was greater at one thing than Dennis Rodman. When I think of Dennis Rodman, I go back to the coach aspect of it, but like the best rebounder we've ever seen, and undersized too, like 6'8", right? And that might be, 6'8"-ish, relatively thin, and early in his prime too, people think of him guarding, the big post players later in his career. He was guarding anybody. Not Draymond Green. Okay, Draymond Green, they want to talk about, he can guard all five positions. That's bullshit, because there's no real centers in the NBA anymore.
We're going to cut that out. Draymond doesn't deserve to be in Dennis Rodman's sentence. Can't mention those two in the same sentence.
Well, Dennis Rodman could go Shaquille O'Neal one night to, well, especially in the early 90s when Shaq came in, to shutting Shaq down, to guarding Michael on the perimeter, to guarding whoever. He was the perfect defender. And, and a very high IQ from what people talk about him as far as basketball IQ. But it's a guy that struggled. I felt sympathy during some of it, and so the guy that struggled off the floor. I mean, he had a, suicide is the right word. I can't remember how they used it, but he was in the car late at night in an arena with a gun in his car. A guy that struggled with some demons off the floor. And if you watch ESPN 30 for 30 on his life, the guy was, I think he moved out away from his mother, His mother was homeless for a couple of years. A guy that had some demons, but he channeled all that energy played his ass off night in and night out.
Yeah, I think it was San Antonio where he really changed from, being a little bit off in Detroit, but at least he didn't have like a character. San Antonio, where he met Madonna, I guess, is where he started to be Dennis. And he actually said that. That's where he started to be himself, be happy, wearing the weird hats and the coats and all that. You read the backstory about how he grew up being homeless and stuff. It's crazy that he got to where he was. I mean, when he went to college, the coach just happened to be talking to him. Hey, you want to play basketball? Yeah, sure. I like basketball. And he goes to the NBA. That's just a crazy story to be where he ended up getting. And then obviously, very important part with the Bulls. They probably don't win those three without him, for sure.
And to have that story, the Rodman story, on top of the Pippen story, all on the same team. Like, those are two crazy stories. Right. Like, to get to where they were, where they came from.
Yeah.
But
yeah, I mean, that game seven that they finally when they swept them that final time of the year, they went to the championship. I mean, that foul on Pippen happened. That foul on Pippen where he pushed him into that first round. I mean, when he was with the Pistons,
that was after taking the forearm shiver from Lambeer.
Right.
And then being pushed out.
Right. Exactly.
It was a combo.
Right, and it's not. I mean, it's not. Standing up to the bully. What was weird is that he became a Bull years later, and they became teammates years later. To be able to put, that disdain and hatred aside, and to be able to hear Dennis talk about, I mean, there's sincere love, and you can sense it in him because he's off his rocker, right? He is completely, completely off his rocker. But whenever he talks about Phil, Scotty, and Michael, you can just sense that's real. That's complete. When he's going to be able to, that's the best moments of his life. And then you go back to, when he's later and older and who knows how long he lives, but there's no question listening to him talk about those years that he's looking at those, 3 years as some of the greatest times of his life. And I think Jordan, Pippen, and Phil Jackson were perfect for him for that. They understood. I mean, I'm not going to say they understood him because I don't know how they could understand him. But for somehow, you know what I mean? They're the complete opposite. But somehow, the story that Michael told when Rodman, after getting that bad ejection, came to his hotel room. I'm just trying to be a fly on the wall in that hotel room, and how that must have went. It's like they lit up a cigar, didn't say a word, and then got up and said, "We good? Yeah, we're good. All right."
Yeah, it didn't even get brought up.
No, right? There was no apology.
Yeah,
there was no apology. But like Jordan said, him, he never came to his hotel room, and that when he finally came there, that was what, the message was crystal clear and unspoken. That we're gonna come in and share a cigar, probably do very little talking, get up and we're good. We're good. Basketball IQ, off the hook. But I guarantee you, You watched it last night when he was trying to. He has a hard time communicating anything. You know, he has a hard time talking.
GIF.
Yeah.
He's already become a GIF.
Yes. Well, that's what I was saying.
With the rebounds.
When he's trying to communicate his feelings, he struggles because he struggles communicating. He's got a social, you know, disorder, obviously. And I think that's why he really, you know, enjoyed Phil Jackson, because he really didn't need to communicate any of it. They automatically, you know, understood him. And just a weird cat, man. He's gonna go down as one of the most unique personalities, if not the most unique personality ever to play.
Do you think? Did they say something about? Because we all know Phil Jackson's not really. Phil's a little up there too,
right?
And his was it Indian culture?
Yep.
Am I right?
Yeah.
And going down that, and I think and that was a way to kind of semi connect with Dennis Rodman somehow.
Yep.
I mean, Christ, it blows my mind. I mean, Dennis Rodman is there was a stat 7 times his career, 20 rebounds and no points.
Yeah.
I mean.
And he loved it.
Did you see who the other player was?
Charles Oakley?
No, it's happened 2 other times since Dennis Rodman. Did you see who the other player was? I was shocked when I saw it. It was a trivia thing. It was on the show.
I didn't see it, but I can't.
Just go.
I don't know. Marcus Camby.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
20 rebounds and no points. I was like, wow.
Yeah.
Sneaky, solid player.
Too, if you fast forward that, I mean, before the recent news, but Dennis Rodman, I can't say without laughing, Dennis Rodman is also meeting with the North Korean dictator. You know what I mean? I mean, just a guy that just, it blows my mind.
Yeah, he started acting like the U.S. ambassador to North Korea.
Perfect.
Yeah, right.
And it might have been perfect.
They loved each other.
Yeah.
They did.
But, I mean, we've all, as coaches, we've all been around some players throughout our careers at some point that unspoken actions are almost more powerful than pulling them aside and trying to communicate with them, especially troubled ones, you know, that have heard everything. I can't remember if it was Chuck Daly. Yeah, it was Chuck Daly. I'm trying to think of the documentary where one of Chuck Daly's assistant coaches were trying to, the whole don't put a saddle on a stallion,
yes,
or something like that.
Yeah.
Just leave him. They were trying to coach him and drill him or whatever, and he just pulled him aside and said, you know, let. And that's what I think Dennis needed. You know, for him, I think a lot of talking was BS. You know, you're going to say it's all going to be cliches and stuff, but you know, Phil could, and obviously Chuck Daly, by their actions and how they treated him without, you know, speaking to him, that's what Dennis needs. Because, you know, he's probably, like I said, some of his social disorders made communicating very difficult, where Phil letting him go to Vegas, you know, spoke more than any speech or any pulling aside. Said, yeah, go ahead, you got 48 hours.
Yeah.
Michael just like, what?
That was one of the...
You let this dude go to Vegas for 48 hours. We're not getting
We're not ever getting him back.
Someone said, everyone, that Dennis Rodman created load management just his own way.
Right.
He was the first one to do it, going to Vegas. But that was actually one of the funnier stories, I thought, was him going to Vegas and coming back and...
Yeah.
Phil saying, doing the Indian run, and them all running slow, and then when Rodman went, it took them 4 laps to catch up to him the morning after he got back, which I thought was, I mean, we've kind of all been there with the early morning practice in college, the day after, you're kind of dragging a little bit, and this guy just got back from Vegas, and
a freak.
Just running by people still, he's just a different cap.
And they're doing the conditioning for him.
Right.
Yeah. And he was probably in better shape than
and they're all level. Right. They're all trying to screw it up a little bit, saying you jog really slow.
You watch some of those highlights they were showing of some of the balls that he kept alive and was battling bigger, stronger. I mean, it's 100% energy and conditioning.
Yeah.
I mean, for him to hop 4 or 5 times, you know, outstretched, dive into the stands, get up, sprint down, get a dunk, you know, and just, I mean, he was a freak.
Yeah, they said that he used to ask teammates if they wanted to get shots up so he could just go rebound for them, so he could learn the angles
that's
watching the ball
that's
going in.
Become the GIF.
Yeah,
Yeah,
when he's that explaining one. That. The ball comes off this way, he's got to go this way.
Right.
He comes this way, he's got to go this way.
And I think there is something to that, obviously. Like, yeah. Right.
Yeah.
What's that?
We always say, talk about being, as coaches, be great at your role. Not everybody can be the star, but everybody can be the star at the role, whatever that cliche BS is. Like, nobody did it better than Dennis Rodman. Like,
no.
Nobody.
No.
Like, and you talk about a guy, if you send him through skills and drills, or you got some AU coach throwing a tennis ball while he's dribbling, okay, he's probably like the last person to ever be in the NBA.
Right.
But no one was more important to winning than, or a huge part of winning than him.
Forget as coaches, man. We, all of us as players, would love playing with a Dennis Rodman. Mm-hmm. We can all go back and probably recall a teammate that didn't care if they scored. They wanted the rebound. They were the greatest, you know, teammates. And mm-hmm. you know, when you put yourself in Jordan and Pippen's shoes, how can you not love playing with someone right. like that? And as long as you know all of his antics, you know, it was so funny to see how they reacted to it. Was he had freaking 19 rebounds last night. I don't care if he was out until 3 a.m. if he shows up tomorrow, which he'll, you know, which he will, and continue to help us win, who cares if he has right. you know, purple hair and
or he's a bridal dress
and is wearing a wedding dress. I mean, he's gonna show up and, you know, and give us 10 points and 19 rebounds, and he was great at it.
Breaking news, Seth Farrington says Dennis Rodman was more important to winning than Michael Jordan. Moving on. So, a key to Rodman's success, I thought, was Phil Jackson, which I obviously knew that Phil Jackson was a great coach, but watching that, really, it really stuck out to me. So, I don't know if that was the case for you guys, but they talked about him a lot. Did this change his legacy to you guys at all? Or were you guys more in tune with it because you lived it?
Did that change anything with you?
Jackson's legacy?
How he was shown last yeah. night, did that make him...
No, because I think we all knew that. It was the whole... Because what did he major in college? Psychology. So he was big into the whole, like, doing yoga at practices.
Zen.
Yeah, the Zen. He was always big into that.
What did he do for Jordan that was different than maybe what was going on before?
Trust his teammates more.
Got him to do that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think they correlated Doug Collins, which was give the ball to Jordan, everybody else get out of the way.
That's right, the quote.
To bring in Jackson in with the triangle. But you can't say that that's what did it, because Doug Collins had that team on the verge of
building every year.
Of breaking through. So obviously the triangle worked, but he was averaging 37 with Doug Collins. I mean, he's still averaging over 30 points a game in the triangle. So, right. You know, so did it work? Yeah, I mean, obviously it did, but you can't say that Doug Collins wasn't going to be able to get in there either.
I think more important of them getting over the hump was the maturation of Pippen and Horace Grant and all that, more so than the triangle. And that's not taking anything away from Phil and the triangle at all. Right. You know, do I think Pippen still becomes the player that he became with or without the triangle? And I think Phil's success is more about his relationships and building trust as a team and all the stuff that he did, kind of quirky, with the team, more so than the triangle. More so than, well, Jordan figured out, or Phil made Jordan figure out that it's not about him, it's about the triangle offense and running that. I think what Phil's strength was his relationships with his players, the trust that he built with his players, and those types of relationships were, I think, more important than Tex Winter's, you know, triangle offense. I mean, even when Kobe and Shaq, you know, he was able to make that work, right. Where I think he's probably the only one on the planet that could have made that work for a period of time.
And Seth, I'll let you answer in a second, but just to go on that, Paxson. He had that big fourth quarter in the...
Did I call that?
It was game...
Was you thinking when you were...
Last game.
Yes.
Was you thinking about that?
It was a closeout game. We were tied at 80 going in the fourth quarter.
But episode?
Yes, right.
When I said Paxson didn't miss a shot against the Lakers?
Yeah, so in the huddle, I think they talked about how Jackson... Was it Jackson that told him, like, hey...
Paxson's open.
And that was when... Maybe he saw a turn in Jordan really trusting his teammates because Paxson just
right. I still think they
knocked it down. So that's what I was going to ask. So does that type situations, Paxson become what he is, or these other players become what they are alongside Jordan without the triangle? Does that make sense?
I've done enough talking.
I'll go. I'm with Scott 100%.
Yep.
And I'm not trying to knock Phil Jackson. I think what Phil Jackson's greatest strength was, what he just touched on, was relationship building and delegating to smarter people. So you always say, if you want a great staff, you know, get a bunch of people that know more about basketball than you. And Tex Winter was the man. Okay, he gets, I mean, in the coaching circles, we all know him, but as far as like media out, you know, he doesn't get the credit that he deserves. But it's more about the, you know, Michael Jordan coming into his prime with, more importantly, Scottie Pippen, Horace Grant. And like, listen, no, I'm not going to knock Paxson, but I mean, he's not being guarded. Okay, you're an NBA player. Make a goddamn shot. Okay, he's 20 pass through the ball. He's double and triple team. All you got to do is step into it and shoot it and make it. Okay, it's not rocket science. And you know, I think the whole triangle is a little bit, I think it's overhyped quite a bit. I think it's more about those other players, especially Pippen and Grant, like you said, coming into their prime.
No, I know. I agree.
Yeah, and you're going on the box scores of those. He was 8 for 8 in game 2. He took 11 shots in game 3 and game 4. He took 12 that final game 5. So it's not like he wasn't shooting before that.
Right.
So, I mean, I know they played it off that way, but he was 9 for 12 in that game 5.
What was he for the series?
For shooting?
For the series, yeah.
They don't have that breakdown.
I just gave
a quick calculation in my head, but
right. I mean, those were all perimeter jump shots, and like you said, you're a pro. But I mean, he shot unbelievably that whole series.
Right,
it was like 80% off mid range and 3-point shots.
Well, the crazy part, he was only 1 for 2, 3, 4. 1 for 4 from 3.
Right.
The rest of them were all mid range jumpers.
Yep.
That they don't shoot anymore.
Right.
That but game 2, he was 8 for 8.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. 6 assists. But it's not like he wasn't shooting before that, right. And all of a sudden he just said, well, Paxson's open, you gotta give him the ball.
Well, he had like 27 field goal attempts.
Yeah, right.
He
had one more than, he had 11 in 2 previous games.
Right.
I feel bad for Doug Collins.
I know, and I said that either, was it last, or the last dance?
Yeah.
You know, I thought he got, I mean, I loved him. Absolutely loved him.
That may have been the line of the except for Horace Grant, but
yeah,
the press conference. What play was that? It was called
Get the ball to Mike
and get the
which has always been a bleep. I've seen that 1,000 times over my life. That press conference, and it's always
his
bleep.
First game with Doug Collins.
Michael
dropped 50 points. Yeah, 50, 20, 20 in the fourth quarter. And then he also he went to, you know, Doug Collins has said, I won't let you lose this game going into the fourth quarter. I won't let you lose your first game.
Yeah.
And I think their relationship has it, if you fast forward to the Wizards, you know, yes, Jordan wanted to come back, but also a big part of it was his head coach, who was the Wizards coach at the time.
Yeah. He definitely loves Doug Collins. There's no question. Doug Collins, I mean, made him into an MVP. Not made him, but gave him the opportunity to just take the league over, really. I mean, he was on his way anyway, so it's hard to give anybody... He deserves all the credit, MJ does, but I mean, Doug Collins set up plays to just get the ball to him and everyone else just get out of the way.
I don't think that's who he was. You go look and play with he's a big, you know, Dean Smith guy. Dean Smith put in him about, you know, sharing the ball, you know, keeping the ball. He was the only first coach to keep him under 20, so to speak. But I think Michael Jordan was one of the, you know, most unselfish teammates. It's just when your teammates are terrible around you, it's going to fall more on his shoulders, in my opinion.
Well, that's what he said was a funny line too. Is when, you know, about getting the ball and having the ball in Cartwright's hands more than what he, I can't remember. He threw an F bomb, which was awesome. I can't remember the exact thing that he said.
Yeah, I don't want the ball in his hands with 5 seconds left because the triangle says so.
Right, exactly. 5 seconds left.
Ball in Bill Cartwright's hand with 5 seconds to go because
that's what the triangle was. They kind of talked about.
So they made a big deal about the triangle offense being brought in, right?
Yes.
So that was in 89-90.
Mm-hmm.
So, from 87 through 89, Jordan averaged 24 shots a game. And shot his first 87, 88, 89, he shot about 53% from the field. So his first year in the triangle, he shot 24 shots a game, which was actually more, and shot 53%, which was actually a little bit less. And then the 2 years after that, the three world championships, he shot 22 a game, 23 a game, and 25 a game. So his shots didn't really go down.
Look at the final series against Phoenix.
So his shots really didn't go down.
Yeah.
So when people say he's going to get his teammate, well, he's taking the same amount of shots.
His shots didn't go down, but his efficiency went way up.
What does that mean?
Player efficiency rating?
Actually, it didn't.
Field goal percentage?
I think it takes a measure of permanent production.
So the two previous years,
he was playing the
54, 55, 55 in the first year of the triangle, 55 the next year, 53, which is his lowest one.
What's he talking about?
And then the efficiency percentage, you just said.
I mean, no, PR is 31.7, 31.1. 31.2, 31.6.
What are you talking about?
Which, what? Shots per game, field goal attempts, and shooting percentage is all I care about. And how much, I mean, minutes.
Well, efficiency minutes field goal per percentage was on here.
Yeah, no. Player efficiency rating is what you should be looking at.
No, that's not what I should be looking at.
This one right here?
No, that's effective field goal percentage. That combines wins. I think that's 2 point, 3 points together, adjusting for the fact that.
So I'm just saying, though, his shots attempted, which is what people want you to, by them saying that the triangle made his, get his teammates involved, took you would assume shots. The number,
his assist went up,
the numbers right. would be, translate to less field goal shots, right. which they didn't. They actually went up the first year.
Right.
Because 24 was one of, well, except for when he played with the off brands.
Right. Well, yeah, no, that's that. I'm just saying his player his efficiency rating was higher once the triangle started.
And I think that's. I don't think it's when the triangle started. I think it's when Pippen became an all-star.
Yes.
Now all of a sudden, okay, now sure, all yeah. of a sudden, you got. I think it's less triangle related than it is to the growth and the maturation right. of Scottie Pippen and Horace Grant and John Paxson and the buildup of that team. More so than, you know, the triangle offense.
Right, but the way they say that.
Oh, yeah, no,
you to perceive
absolutely.
That he took left shots and got his teammates involved, which is why they started winning.
Right.
But the numbers don't show that.
No.
I mean, that's the perception that they want
I
to
I think
see.
If you went and dug into the real number, the more important numbers would be the surrounding cast's shooting percentage and shots probably taken and rebounding and all the other important stats in the basketball. If you take Jordan away and you take the whole rest of the Chicago Bulls and their stats, where it went from 1985 to 7 and then from 1987 to 80 to 90, that supporting cast got so much better.
Right.
His last year,
I think
Collins offense,
the shooting percentage
eight assists a game. First year in the triangle, 6 assists a game, so his assists went down. But he got his teammates involved.
Yeah. No, I don't think that. I mean, yeah. If you want to go off that the raw stuff, like you can take the same
the raw
you,
stuff. Those are numbers.
You can take the same amount of shots per game, but and this may not be the case. I'm just saying, but maybe in the triangle, hypothetically, 6 of those shots now in the triangle came on swinging the ball all the way around the perimeter to catch and shoot, as opposed to.
But then that would
hold on a second, as opposed to going 1-on-3 and dribbling the ball for a jump shot.
Then that would affect the shooting percentage, right?
Right. Which didn't drop.
Wait, no. Never over-dribble.
So if you're making a
the
shot,
ball can, the ball
shot.
Can move more and you can be more efficient.
If you're making
just
a
because
shot,
your
shot.
Shots. But he became more efficient as a player once at that time when the triangle took over. So like shot attempts may be the same, but maybe the shots were a little bit different and easier.
So wouldn't you see that
which would affect shooting percentage?
Or his points per game?
Now he became this distributor, and now he became less of a scorer, and now he became
I'm willing to say if we have a coach's thing on after, that somebody will say that.
We'll say what?
That he started winning when he stopped shooting so much.
We started passing more.
Because it's said all the time.
Okay, well, let's not bring it up. So when we have a few guests on later,
then we call. Oh, there it is! There it is!
Let's not say that this was part of what we talked about tonight. Let's just see.
Make me sound like a smart guy. I'm like, Chris, do you got the numbers for me?
Episode 3 and 4. It seems like every week it just gets a little bit better. Episode 5 and 6 coming next week. The week kind of drags, and the episode's coming. It flies by.
Yeah.
What are you guys looking forward to in episode 5 and 6?
Dream team. Summer of my senior year. Summer of my senior year, and it was pure gold.
Same.
No pun intended.
Sure. I'll go with Dream Team.
Right, yeah. Dream Team?
I mean, anything. It's all great stuff.
Yeah, I'm with the dream team, and hopefully some more burns on Isaiah Thomas.
Yeah, baby.
All right, I'm looking forward to it.
See you next week, Seth.